And giving them some alternative to appeal to.
Yeah, I want to go back a little bit to the media's role in this, Anousheh, because you don't see the kind of obsessive coverage, even though you do see coverage of it, of the, you know, the undocumented person or the you know, the immigrant who's fearing deportation, particularly the black immigrant that's fearing deportation. You almost never see that story, or the Muslim family that's feeling othered in their community. I mean, there've been stories, individual stories about, you know, harassment of people, harassment of individuals, defacement of their homes. But the media is not as involved or doesn't seem to be as invested in the stories of non-Trumpists as it is in Trumpists. Is that a matter of the non-diversity of the pool that's covering politics?
I think it totally is. I mean, that has to, diversity in the newsroom is going to affect the news, just like we saw so many of the anchors, major anchors like Matt Lauer and Charlie Rose, who were really shaping the conversation when the election was still going on. And they ended up being, you know, sexist, sexual predators. Imagine how that affected the coverage of Hillary Clinton. But what I think is really terrifying, and as someone who grew up in a country where journalists were murdered, there's no such thing as press freedom. You say something against the ruling party, you know, you could wind up disappeared or dead. But what is really dangerous in the first year of Trump's presidency is his consistent attacks on the free press and how that term fake news has entered the mainstream. And the terrifying thing is that much like in Russia and RT, our president has a news channel that mainstreams racism, that normalizes his hate-filled language. He has a megaphone and a forum for his hate. And in America now, it's becoming something really real. And the mainstream is now suddenly fake news. Anything that is not positive coverage to Trump can be dismissed as not real. So not only do we have alternative facts, but in the first year of Trump's presidency, he's managed to successfully create an alternative reality. And Fox News is reinforcing that message.
Yeah, but, you know, and to that point, though, Donald Trump, you know, Gabriel, isn't just watching Fox News. He's watching, he is watching himself reflected back on all the news channels. In the Michael Wolff book, Fire and Fury, he talks about in his first days, Trump ordered two television screens in addition to the one already in his room. If he's not having his 6:30 dinner with Steve Bannon, then more to his liking, he's in bed by that time with a cheeseburger watching his three screens, making phone calls. From the New York Times in December, around 5:30 each morning, Trump wakes up and tunes into the television in the White House's master bedroom. He flips to CNN for news, moves to Fox and Friends for comfort and messaging ideas, and then watches MSNBC's Morning Joe because, as friends suspect, it fires him up for the day. It's estimated he watches at least 4 hours a day, sometimes as much as 8 hours a day in front of a TV. So Donald Trump is actually needing and absorbing more than just Fox.
Yeah.
He wants to see himself reflected on all of the news media. I'm wondering if that affects the way all of the media covers him. Are they just giving in to letting him see himself?
I mean, I think without question, Donald Trump sort of sees himself as the executive producer of this giant TV show that he is starring in. And I think, yes, I think the danger is that Trump, while he is the biggest story in America, is also great for ratings. And the risk is that the tweets and all of this sort of spectacle that he's creating encourages newsrooms, especially TV news, to then cover it. And it's this feedback cycle that just goes and goes and goes. I think a lot of journalists I know talk to in private talk about what happens the day Donald Trump leaves office, because for a news industry that has been facing economic headwinds, Donald Trump has been a rare bright spot for newsrooms. I mean, the New York Times subscriptions are through the roof, Washington Post, other newsrooms, and TV ratings are through the roof. So I think this is one of the dangers of having a president obsessed with the media.
And what would it look like then to have a media that was a little, that was different, that was more inclusive in terms of the stories, that covered a broader range of issues and people? I mean, can that even survive the era of Trump?
I think it can. I think one of the points that Gabe brings up, the same day that Donald Trump tweeted that he may have recorded conversations with James Comey, that same day, Attorney General Jeff Sessions, just like that, brought mandatory minimums back. You didn't hear a lot about that unless you were watching Joy Reid that weekend. You may have missed that news,
right.
And I think that's a problem. Another thing, I think we've seen the evolution of media in how they cover Trump. So initially, you would hear them say things like, Donald Trump made racist comments again, or made divisive comments. And I think this is something that reporters still struggle with today. At what point can you move from opinion to facts? Mm-hmm. I think at this point, we can say, Donald Trump is a racist. This is no longer a hypothesis or, you know, something that you can ponder. As evidenced by his policies and his comments directly from his mouth, we can say Donald Trump is a racist. And I don't think that you hear a lot of that until the past 2 weeks with the shithole comments. Mm-hmm. But before that, you didn't really hear a lot of reporters bold enough to make that assertion.
Yeah, you'll see sort of euphemisms like racially tinged comments, racially
right.
divisive.
Racially charged, yeah, yeah. Yeah. And even then, when people finally say it, we spend a week talking about the fact that Donald Trump is racist, something people have known for decades, and we still don't know the details of what's in the compromise bill mm-hmm. that Lindsey Graham and Dick exactly. Durbin are putting on the table, that everyone is saying is the answer to all of our problems and the answer to immigrants' problems. We don't even know what's all in the bill. That's the problem. Really quickly, Jamal.
Jay, the one thing I think we ought to be thankful to Donald Trump for is that he's going to make people choose. You can't really fudge the middle here. You either on the side of the people who think that straight, white, Christian men get everything, or the side of the people who think that everybody else in America ought to be able to participate at some level of equality.
Yeah.
I think he is driving that choice for us and making it starkly clear.
He absolutely is. I think they think that pool is bigger.
Not.
Yeah, they're making that pool. He thinks that pool is really big. We'll see how big it is. Tiffany Cross and Anousheh Hossain will be back. Thank you, Gabe Sherman and Jamal Simmons. Appreciate you guys.
Thank you.